last Christmas, we put out the Kiss episode. I called it Kiss Mexicans because we were reviewing Kiss Meets the Phantom of the Park and Detroit Rock City.
Yes.
And this, I used this picture to promote it. And I called it Before the Money. And the reason I called it Before the Money is because this is what the band was before money entered into the situation. Now, you notice this. Look at this photo. They're all very happy. And they were poor. They were like cash poor. And Neil Bogart had just started Casablanca. This photo was taken sometime between the end of 1973, the beginning of 1974. And you can see that the makeup and the costumes are not as elaborate as they would be in later times.
No, they're very basic.
And look at Peter. He's smiling. Look at Gene doing his traditional, you know, demon thing. Looks like he's going to eat Bullockoin's head. Bullockoin has his tongue sticking out. Ace is laughing. He's having a great time. Paul is cradling Joyce's posterior and her legs and her feet in his hands. And Neil is on the outside of the picture with a cigarette in his hand, smiling. And this is what it was before the money. You look up these same people 3 years later, maybe 4 years later, and they're all starting to become miserable because they've just found out that they've become millionaires. And to me, this is the Kiss I want to remember. This is the band I want to remember. I don't want to think about what they are now. I don't want to think about what happened later on. I always wanted to go back to this time because I think the very first song I ever heard was Rock and Roll All Night, because my mother went to a record store and she picked up the 45 of it. She was like, oh, this is popular. Some kind of rock and roll music, and here, listen to it. And whatever, I had a record player and I put it on, fell in love with it immediately. Just played it over and over again. And it was a kid thing. And I was like, I don't know, 1979, 1978, maybe? Probably 79. And I was 6 years old. Maybe, probably seven. I don't know, was it seven? Let me say 72. I can't even tell
you. You'd have been six in 78 or seven in 79.
I know it was after my birthday. So I had to have been seven because my mother stopped at a butcher to pick up a turkey for Thanksgiving dinner. And there was a record store next to the butcher, and they were going to kill a live turkey, and she said, go into the record store next door. She didn't want me seeing it. So,
a good mom. She doesn't want to see her precious little baby boy watch an animal get slaughtered. Maybe nothing wrong with
that. At the time, she was a good mom. Things would change later on. But I went in, and I was like, the Cars, Blondie, Fleetwood Mac, Kiss, Meatloaf. That's the kind of stuff you saw in a record store back then. She picked that out for me, and she got it for me. She had the turkey in a bag, you know. They plucked the feathers and everything, and she had it in a bag. And, you know, actually, I got to tell you, fresh turkey is so much better than store-bought, but hey.
Oh, yeah, I believe it. We had my mother-in-law, not to get too far up, does Amish turkey.
Amish turkey.
Amish turkey. Gets them from Amish people, and them turkeys taste really good.
This is how I choose to remember, you know, when it comes to the memories, the things that are going on in my mind. When I think about the good things, this is what and this is a great photo, because it's like, they're not playing a part. They're not doing their characters or their personalities or whatever it is. They're just like a glam band. They're a glam rock band in New York in 1974. And
they're just being them, you know?
And all these people here were the actual people who put Kiss on the map. Neil Bogart's Casablanca Records. Bullockoin was their manager. Joyce co-managed the band with Bill before she became Mrs. Bogart. And they're all featured in this new movie that just came out called Spinning Gold.
I think that movie is going to be so inaccurate.
Well, it obviously is. I mean, I looked at 5 seconds of it and knew it was inaccurate. But we should watch it before we do our second episode. I guess this episode we're going to cover like the first four, maybe 5 years before the money.
Before basically Kiss Alive, like we're going up to Kiss Alive,
I will go as far. You know what? I go as far as Destroyer. I would say. Okay. I think Love Gun is when it changed, when it all changed. Somewhere between Rock and Roll Over and Love Gun. But I wanted to talk a little bit about Neil Bogart and what he did. He was around for years. He not even that long. I mean, he died such a young death, and it was just so tragic when you think about it. But he started a label called Buddha? No, he worked on Buddha Records.
Yeah, worked on Buddha Records.
which produced a lot of like novelty pop hits back in the 60s, 50s, late 50s, early 60s kind of stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then he sought out on his own and he started, his real name is Neil Bogatz, but he always called himself Neil Bogart, and he painted himself in the role of Humphrey Bogart in Casablanca, which if you look at the very early record labels of their earliest releases, there are these alternate labels that have him decked out as Humphrey Bogart on the label itself. So he's kind of a Casablanca nut. So he started Casablanca Records, which was basically just one floor in one high rise in Midtown. They didn't have any money, and he bluffed his way into an enormous distribution deal with Warner Brothers.
Yep.
Which gave him money right away. But the problem, okay, you know, we're going to talk about things that they don't talk about on Kiss Podcasts, and I'm going to be real about this, and I'm also going to be real about all the bullshit that has happened over the last, I don't know, 20 years or so with the band. And I want to say, Kiss is my entry into rock and roll, so I can look back on that time with a certain level of affection, but I can also look back on it with a lot of anger, too.
I was going to say, you can look on it with, you know, happiness and disdain.
It's like family. You know how you are with family.
Oh, yeah.
You love them, but you hate them, too, at the same time.
Yeah.
So Neil Bogart was a terrible, terrible businessman.
That's so I'm told. He was not that good.
He is proof positive that you need to have a good head on your shoulders when you are dealing with a lot of money. I started watching a new show last week called Billions on Showtime. It's not blowing up my skirt, but it's an interesting microcosm of how finance works, especially in New York and all these rich people and people like that, new money and old money. Neil Bogart's definitely a new money kind of guy. He's a guy who flips out when he sees a pile of money on a table or something. And he says, how can we turn this into a big bowl of cocaine? That was like the whole – I read a book called Party Every Day. I think it was a story of Casablanca as written by Larry Harris's co-guy over there.
Mm-hmm.
His VP or whatever. So I was thinking about Neil Bogart, and I was thinking about how he didn't know how to make money, but he knew how to spend money. That's going to be the problem with Spinning Gold, because I know that his son wrote and directed it, and his son is probably going to deify him. These are my pre-watch thoughts. I'll watch the movie at some point this week. But the way it looks is, oh my God, Neil Bogart was an incredible forerunner of some kind of rock and roll thing or music. In general, I call him the Disco King because Casablanca, made most of their money.
That's right? It. Well, because, okay, I know you're the expert here, so I already told you I'm letting you do most of the leading. But what I know is this. They pioneered the live album. Like, when I'm saying a live record, like, no one ever thought of selling a live album like that until Casablanca. So that was their big thing. And after that, with all the cash infusion, then they became the Disco label.
I would agree with you on the live thing, except...
Well, it wasn't even really okay.
What they did was they made embellishments, I guess.
Right. I already know.
Remember, Frampton Comes Alive.
Right. But that was okay. That's a different story. Different. That's A&M versus Casablanca at the time. Now they're under the same banner because of the whole Universal thing, but whatever.
Oh, remember Casablanca also. They were not a big record company. And I have this idea. I was thinking that if Kiss had not been signed with Casablanca, they would have been a much bigger success, because Casablanca had very limited distribution after they lost their deal with Warner.
That's true, but nobody else wanted to touch them, though. See that's where we're getting to in
the
story.
They were kind of like Canon, right? They were like, well, Canon. They were like the
where we really have to start is the beginning, and we'll gloss over it real quick because I'll tell you what I know. Mm. We need to trace it back to Wicked Lester.
Right,
okay.
Wicked Lester.
Long story short. Gene and Paul were in Wicked Lester. They had an album deal with Epic. They recorded the album. Epic deemed it unreleasable. The album has never seen the light of day, and Wicked Lester broke up. But then Gene and Paul got along, and then they wanted to, you know, do the whole go
That's
start
a
rock and roll band that other people wanted to see. But then after they did that, nobody wanted to touch them. Casablanca was the only label that showed interest.
That's a really strange thing. I've heard that story before, but I've heard the Wicked Lester record. I've heard it. It's not unlistenable. There's far worse shit that was coming out at that time. Wicked Lester was just sort of like, there was no pizzazz, I think. And I think that's one of the things Gene Simmons is always talking about. He's like, He said that they weren't anything interesting.
I mean, like you just said, it wasn't terrible, but at the same time, it wasn't anything special or groundbreaking.
There's a couple of Kiss songs. There's a couple of like early versions of Kiss songs on that Wicked Lester album. The song She, the song Lover All I Can, a couple of songs that showed up later on Dressed to Kill. The only difference is the band sounds a lot more they're much tighter on Dressed to Kill than they are on the Wicked. Wicked Lester's kind of a mess. It sounds like it's really like, you know, badly recorded. Maybe that's what they meant. Maybe some of the recording was a little bit rough. But really, I've heard far worse records coming out around the same time than that one. I don't think they were well liked or something, or maybe they didn't have connections or something like that. But, you know, Bogart did. That's the one thing, the one true quality Casablanca possessed in 1975 was loyalty. That's really what they were incredibly loyal to the band. They gave them
that was the band that was going to make or break them. Remember, like Dressed to Kill flopped, and the Kiss Alive album literally was the album that saved Casablanca. That was the album saved them.
Yeah, they recorded the first record. They threw a lot of promotion behind it.
And I was going to say they did throw a. I remember because of course I wasn't there. But I remember watching all the documentaries and stuff like that, like how Gene was on like the Mike Douglas show or something like that. And there was like
weird and shit. Yeah.
Yeah. And then they had like all these, you know, they had to book these TV performances. They played Firehouse. They played all that stuff. But it was promotion that went nowhere because the album stalled. But the band had a big live at like they got a live following around that time. Because they put on a hell of a show.
It was like Michigan and Cleveland and places.
They were Midwest, dude. They were Midwest. They were us, like our area.
Yeah,
like
they were ignored in New York and Los Angeles at the time. But the first record barely broke the top 100, and then the second record came out a couple of months later, Hotter Than Hell, and that to me is like it's so disappointing to me because it's such. I was listening to Hotter Than Hell last night a little bit. I have it on vinyl, and I was listening to my original vinyl copy of it, and I was listening to it on the record player, and I was just like, I don't know why Kenny Kerner and Richie Wise produced both albums, but for some reason they went out to LA to produce at the Village Recorder, and I'm gonna put some photographs in here too because they photographed an orgy with Kiss, and they used one or two of the pictures on the back cover of the record, but I have the actual uncensored photos here, which I hope you enjoy. But those are some of the best songs the band has ever done. Oh, I mean, like Parasite. Yeah, it's Parasite.
Ton of great songs off that record. It's just the album itself just sounds.
What did I tell you? It sounded like a wet paper towel inside an empty tuna can. That's what the quality of the audio was. It was terrible. And
I always say fishbowl and reverb. That's my whole thing. Fishbowl, reverb, and muddy. I mean, now granted, I know of a few albums that sound muddy. Best example from a band that took inspiration from Kiss, Twisted Sister. The very first record they did, Under the Blade, was
this is a couple of years before they got.
Oh, this is before they really, really blew up.
Because they had been around for years before.
Right. This album came out. It came out in like 1981. It was on Secret Records. It was only released in the UK at first. Okay, and it does have a little bit of a muddy sound to it. And even Atlantic, now when Twisted Sister broke big and 85 rolled along, Atlantic got the rights to Under the Blade and re-released it. They polished the fuck out of it. Mm. It is like, you got to hear original 81 versus the 85 remix. Dude, even though the 81 is a little more rough.
I've seen so many podcasts where these producer types would tell you it's impossible to take those original masters and then improve them. And I'm like,
okay, that's number one. As they say in the movie, you don't mess with the zone. That's bullshit talking. Or that's bullshit.
There are three examples of Kiss records that need desperately to be repaired. One is Hotter Than Hell.
Okay.
The second one is Unmasked. And the third one is Crazy Nights.
Crazy Nights was just mixed very low. The album itself doesn't sound bad. It's too tinny. It's not mixed well.
There's not enough bass.
In the
final mix, the keyboard is just way too dominating. Bring the keyboard down. Don't get rid of the keyboard. A lot of people are like, get rid of the keyboard. I say, turn the keyboard down. Don't get rid of it because It is a product of its time. Remember, 1987, this was...
corporate rock.
You know,
rock.
Ron Nevison produced it. He produced Heart, you know? And if you listen to his work, that's what he sounds like. He's not one of my favorite producers. He's not... I don't know. Who's a really great producer that I can think of? Bruce Fairbairn is a great producer.
Yeah, Bruce Fairbairn. Yeah, he was great. Bob Rock, of course, because he worked with Motley Crue, Metallica.
Yeah, also,
Rick fucking Rubin. Rick Rubin.
Who produced Adele. And also, I mean, among other things, he produced a lot of stuff with Nile Rodgers and stuff like that. But also Bob Ezrin and Eddie Kramer. You know?
Yeah, they were the ones that really helped polish Kiss's sound.
And I mean, like, Eddie Kramer worked with Led Zeppelin. Bob Ezrin worked with Pink Floyd. I mean, this is just incredible name producers, those guys.
And now I can tell you one example of an album that did get fixed, Rush's Vapor Trails. A lot of fans, while they liked the album, they complained about how it sounded, and they went back and remastered it and remixed it X amount of years later. And no, the new version sounds way better.
Yeah, but maybe we should just go along with the idea that because these things are products of their time, they should be left alone. Or if you want to be like, I don't know, Ridley Scott, keep the original, but also do your remix. Don't be like George Lucas and just remove the original.
Hey, we have no problem with you being revisionist. Just keep the original around so we can have some reference here.
You did. I showed you those Eddie Kramer demos that they did. They went to Eddie Kramer first. You know, and the thing, Eddie Kramer produced incredible demos of those five songs that we would hear on both records, and they sound wonderful. But the problem is, Eddie Kramer costs money, and Casablanca didn't have it, so they used their own in-house production team.
Yeah, I was just going to say, they couldn't afford Eddie Kramer. Yeah, they couldn't afford him.
They couldn't afford Eddie Kramer for a full-scale album. He was cheaper when he was on the sideline recording the demos. After that, they do So Hotter Than Hell fails, but they're still touring. They're touring consistently, and they're going outside the United States too. I just don't understand why Neil Bogart didn't see automatically the visual appeal of everything, because he didn't record concerts, and they didn't really put out the music videos. They put out promo pieces. They didn't do anything that involved really selling the visual quality.
Right, but that was a time that was kind of unheard of back then. You got to remember, when the term live album was, people considered it a throwaway back in those days. Like, it was just like a cheap, what a live album was considered a cheap way to make a quick buck, okay? Not to be revolutionary. It's like, oh, we got a live album in the can, we'll release it, and oh, we'll make our record label a couple of bucks, and, you know, the band can take off for a little bit.
And also, the band likes to do it too, because the band, if it's a double live album, that's two records off their contract.
Exactly.
Once you get the contract, you're working to get off the contract. That seems to be the issue.
And then right after Hotter Than Hell, like, I think they got pulled from the tour. Yeah, I remember the story. They got pulled from the tour to record Dress to Kill.
That was Neil Bogart's idea, and he went in and produced the record. He actually produced the record, and it sounds much better.
It does. It sounds
great. Dress to Kill is probably one of my top five, because every song is really good. It's finally hitting that kind of thing where
Come On and Love Me is like my favorite song from that.
Come On and Love Me, it reminds me of a Beatles song. It's like a slightly harder Beatles song, that's all. Right? This is the first record that makes it into the top 40, and it winds up at number 33. And the thing is, Casablanca is on its way out at this point.
Yeah,
so
they're
Bill
done.
Bill Acoin, their manager. This guy moved heaven and earth for Kiss, and he financed their entire tour on his American Express card. And they didn't really have much going on. They had a couple of, you know, pot explosions on stage and a couple of candelabras, right? And the big sign. And they had a very small crew, like three or four people. That was it. They weren't traveling in semis yet. They were just traveling in a string of vans, basically. And that's where they kept all the equipment. And Bill Acoin financed the whole thing. And he got his money back in more ways than one. Then they recorded. They recorded three shows. One of them was for was in Cleveland, but it wasn't for. It was for a TV or a radio show or something, and that was like a really good audio masters that they used. But unfortunately, now this is a point of controversy.
I know the whole ADRing and all that other shit. Like,
yeah, they replaced a lot of
things. Basically, it's like, yeah, the album's live in a sense, but for the most part, a lot of it was done in studio.
All right, and I can compare this too, because I have a live. I have a couple of other live records. I have Peter Frampton. Frampton Comes Alive. I have a Bob Seger live album. I have a ZZ Top, Fandango, which the first side is live. And I have Heart, Dog and Butterfly, which has a couple of live songs. They used to mix like live songs with studio songs back then, too.
Yeah.
But the Bob Seger, well, Fandango is a combination.
Are you talking about Nine Tonight or Live Bullet for Bob Seger?
Live Bullet.
That was the album that got him moving. That was his, that was
like
Bob
one
Seger's.
Of my favorite live records. I love listening to that thing. And I wasn't big on Bob Seger when I was a kid. I really started to appreciate him later on in life.
Yeah, my dad, he was the same way. Like, my dad was a big Bob Seger nut, and he didn't really get into them until Live Bullet because of Turn the Page. That was my dad's all-time
Turn
favorite
the page,
Bob Seger
yes.
song.
Metallica
that was his
up
all-time favorite
too.
Bob Seger song. Like, I'll tell you right now, in his record collection, it was Live Bullet on up. Like, he didn't have the other albums. Like, you know, the one that had Stranger in Town, he didn't have that one.
You didn't have the when he really got popular, like, you know, Like a Rock.
Well, he didn't have that one on vinyl, released as a single. What I'm just saying is he had Live Bullet, he had Night Moves, Stranger in Town was the album that had, you know, Old Time Rock and Roll. He had that one. He just had, and he had Against the Wind. You know, he had all those on vinyl.
For me, Beautiful Loser.
That was the album I was talking. That's what I meant to say. It was Beautiful Loser.
Beautiful Loser.
He didn't have that on vinyl.
The song itself, Beautiful Loser.
Oh, it's a great song. Great song.
It makes me cry. It brings tears to my eyes listening to that song for some reason. I don't know why. It has an effect on me. But I compare these records with Alive. Alive is none of these records had any extensive remixing or dubbing. And you can tell because Frampton Comes Alive and the Bob Seger one and ZZ Top. They all exist as kind of like a souvenir of the show you're going to see. So the sound doesn't explode all over the place the way Alive does. And Alive explodes because of all the overdubbing that they did. And they wanted it to sound that way. They were very big on that for some reason. To go and overdub the instruments. But I mean, Frampton Comes Alive is a great record. So is the Bob Seger one. So is the Fandango one. It's just not the same kind of music. And this is a problem. The problem is that Casablanca was hemorrhaging money so badly because of all the money they got from Warner Brothers, and then Warner Brothers pulls out of the deal because they don't like Kiss and they don't like Bogart's plans, which involve a lot of disco. He's going to put Donna Summer on the roster. He's going to put Parliament Funkadelic, George Clinton on the roster. He's going to put the Village People. Warner Brothers didn't want to do that.
Around that time, disco was kind of on its way out. But then Saturday Night Fever was the movie. People think that Saturday Night Fever was the whole disco revolution. It's like, no. Saturday Night Fever kept disco alive. Because disco was almost dead until Saturday Night Fever came out.
It did. And then disco is so strange, too, because you have its peak years probably between 1975 and 1978, right? But then by 1979, you started seeing rock and roll music do their own version of disco.
Well, actually, I would extend that to 79 because that's when Bad Girls came out, and that was a big record for Donna Summer.
It was, but then wasn't there a transition from Donna Summer? You know, she went from Bad Girls to She Works Hard for Her Money.
But then at the same time, she did switch record labels because she was on Casablanca for that, and I think she switched over. I don't know.
And then she sued Neil Bogart, I remember. And then they sued back because she tried to get out of her contract, and she had to do one more record for Casablanca, and that was the one with She Works Hard for the Money. So they got all the money from Donna Summer. And then when she got her new record contract, she kind of disappeared. She fell off the map.
Well, she still had a couple top 10 hits up until the end of the 80s. She really did. But that's beside the point. The point is, I agree with you saying that
all the money was made by Casablanca. All the serious money was made by Casablanca, and then promptly, basically, they took $4 million and shoved it up their noses. That's pretty much what happened with Casablanca.
I mean, but hey, they became the label of disco. I mean, they wanted to become a disco label, but Warner Brothers was smart. They were like, no, they were like, oh, this is gonna disco is gonna die.
One other
we don't want to do it.
There was only one other act than Kiss that wasn't disco, and that was T-Rex, I think. They had a deal with Casablanca. And a coin tried to get a couple of other bands onto the label, and he couldn't. He managed a band called Angel, and he managed I don't know if Angel – I think Angel was on Casablanca for one or two records. And there was another band called Warrior that was Vinnie Vincent's first – one of his first bands.
Mm-hmm.
And they tried to get on Casablanca. He didn't get on Casablanca. And then also A Coin Managed Generation X, and then later Billy Idol solo, and they wouldn't take him either because they had no money. And by then their stock, I guess, had depreciated considerably, but that was at the end of the 70s.
Oh, yeah. By then they got absorbed by Polygram. So.
Yeah, yeah. That was like the biggest scam contract I ever saw. But we're jumping ahead of ourselves. Right
yes,
now,
we are.
We are talking about Dress to Kill and the creation of Alive. And then Alive becomes their first top 10 record. And
Rock and Roll All Night, the single version of the live cut, gets re-released. That becomes a very popular radio staple. It becomes a big single.
And this is still before Kiss became millionaire, before the band became millionaires, and when A Coin was recouping, basically. A Coin had a 50-50 deal with the band. For the money they made, he got half of it.
That's not a good deal. A good manager takes 10%.
But you got it's not a good deal, but you have to consider the fact that he paid for them, that he lived off of him.
Yes, and he, you know what?
He gave the money to live.
That's fine. In that case, that's fine, because if he was the guy who put up all that money to help get him going, you know what? I guess asking for 50% on a back end, there's nothing wrong with that.
And then, you know, I mean, later on, they kind of stabbed him in the back. They stabbed him in the back after The Elder, and they fired him because he was, like, the one thing that was taking half of their money. And I guess that's when, I guess, Paul and Gene sort of got more assertive because...
Well, if you honestly think about it, around that time, Kiss fatigue was setting in between, and I don't want to get too ahead, but we're making a point about this, between 78 and 81, more or less 79 and 81, Kiss fatigue was starting to set in. Like, they weren't drawing crowds anymore. Like, people weren't buying their records. Elder fucking flopped like a fish. So I guess at that point, he wasn't doing his job.
Well, they, like, if they don't really have the money and he's taking half of what they don't have anyway, then yeah, he's at that point, he's cancer. You cut the cancer off.
Yeah, so you cut the cancer. He's a liability.
We got to go back. We got to go back and consider a few things. What is it that you really, truly remember about Kiss? I'll ask you because you're not...
I'm younger.
You're not as much of the series. You're more of a conversational fan. You know, Rush is your thing. You're a Rush guy.
Yes, I'm a diehard Rush fan. That's the band I can talk about.
I remember that Rush toured with Kiss.
Yes, they did. I remember that.
And I saw an interview piece where Neil Peart was talking about them, and he was talking about how he had a lot of fun with Peter and Ace, and he really didn't have any fun with Gene and Paul. Gene and Paul were very serious, and they were like completely antipathy of rock. They were more business oriented, and Ace and Peter were the party guys. And he said he had a lot of fun with those guys, but he did not have much fun with the others. But I want to ask you first. I mean, like, you know, what is the thing that you most is closely identified with Kiss for you?
I guess you elaborate. Like, what do you mean closely identified?
First impression. What is it about the band that separates them from everybody else?
Oh, just the make. I mean,
the makeup. Right.
For the makeup. Growing up, it was the makeup.
Exactly.
The makeup.
It's the makeup. That's the one thing. It's not even like terribly original, and a lot of the music itself wasn't particularly original or revolutionary. It was glam rock. All right, glam rock is a combination. I did some research. It's a combination of glitter rock from England, hard rock from the USA, and the beginnings of punk. And we're talking about the very early punk, not the Ramones punk, not the stuff that would become popular later on and then become new wave. We're talking about Iggy Pop, that kind of stuff. Iggy Pop is also...
Iggy and the Stooges, yeah.
It's also...
Or the New York Dolls.
The New York Dolls, big, big thing. There's also Slade and T-Rex and Mark Bolan and all that stuff. But you have punk, glitter, and hard rock. They weren't even the first configuration of American glam rock that made money. Alice Cooper was the first.
Yeah, he was literally one of the first. I mean,
and he sold more records than Kiss.
I was going to say, there's more bands or more musicians that did it. Like, the best you can think of outside of Kiss, you also have David Bowie, dressed up and did this whole persona. And a better one, Peter Gabriel from Genesis.
Peter Gabriel.
He did the exact same thing.
He did that, too. But that came out of necessity, from what I read. Peter Gabriel was incredibly stage shy, and he felt he did not want anyone to see his face. So he put on makeup, and he performed, and he played a part. when Genesis was that kind of progressive rock, I guess, back before Phil Collins. So he did all that to overcome his stage shyness. A lot of performers are, and a lot of actually Paul Stanley was very stage shy, from what I understand, and the makeup helped him in that way. Peter Criss as well. A lot of people do that, and they play a part. Kate Bush is another one, incredibly stage shy. She used to wear lots of makeup too. They weren't particularly original, but what they did have were Kiss had this iconic kind of labeling. They had the logo. That's another thing that really sticks out. Makeup is number one. That iconic Kiss trademarked logo now that everybody seems to be fighting over, which was designed by Ace Frehley, I might add.
Yep.
That is another thing. It's a branding element. So what they were able to do was take a rock band and brand it and turn it into a fucking franchise, which is what I absolutely truly despise about them today.
Yes.
Because it's not about music anymore.
It's not. It's literally about merchandising. That's all Kiss is these days.
They're a corporate entity. It's not rock and roll all night and party every day. It's create product all night and make money all day. And it's everything Neil Bogart couldn't do. This is something that would have saved Casablanca at the time if they had done this back then.
After Love Gun, they started doing, you know, that kind of stuff. You had the Kiss pinball machine, the Kiss
comic. But it didn't last,
the Kiss
though.
Toys.
That's the problem. This started in 77, and by that point, your Kiss fatigue sets in, what you just said. The pinball machine? Fucking shit. The Marvel comic book with the blood in it? That's, you know, this is bullshit. This isn't rock music. This is something else. It's fun, though, for the kids. I know if you're a 5- or 6-year-old or 7-year-old kid, back in the day, you wanted those fucking Kiss dolls. And you know what the Kiss dolls were? It's so hilarious. Those Kiss dolls were just, they were just Ken dolls with black wigs put on them and makeup. And then the costume. So they basically took Ken dolls from the Barbie and Ken set and turned them into Kiss. All the money that was spent on the costumes and the artwork that they did on them. Yeah, they had I had a Kiss lunchbox. I had a t-shirt. My favorite characters, I'd say, if you want to call them the characters, my favorite were Gene Simmons and Ace Frehley. Ace Frehley was mainly my number one.
The Demon and the Spaceman, dude. Those are probably my favorite
Frehley,
too.
And Gene Simmons was just like the biggest over the top queen in the entire band, and he spit blood and fire, and he had blood all over him. It was a very cool image to have, and for a while, I mean, like, Simmons talked about it in the did you see the Kiss exposed thing? Not the exposed, extreme close up. The thing I showed you, right?
Yeah.
The video?
Yeah.
He talked about how at the beginning it was dangerous. It was from the streets. It was lock up your daughters. And then later on it becomes kids are interested. And then what happens? What's the biggest problem you have with kids? Well, they grow up. And then they look back and they say, oh, God, this is stupid. To this day, a lot of people are still embarrassed that they were big Kiss fans when they were kids. But then they reach a certain age, like my age right now, which I'm 50. And I'm like, you know, I've always loved the band. I held on to my records. That was the one thing I really held on to was my records. It was such a visual thing. And the record covers were so goddamn interesting. The artwork was incredible. Ken Kelly and people like that were doing these incredible artworks. And you could buy a record back then and you could actually see the artwork, and then they kind of ruined it with tapes and CDs because it's so small now, you know? And now we don't even practically have, except unless when you're buying these reissues, quote unquote.
Well, yeah, but the funny thing is people are buying more vinyl now than they are CDs
or anything like that.
More people are buying vinyl.
I want to talk about that too, because they're not putting any thought into the fact of all this vinyl, this new vinyl resurgence that's happening. I got into a thing with a guy who runs a vinyl-loving, quote-unquote, podcast on YouTube because he was trying to hawk this new Alice Cooper reissue of Killer. The record came out over 50 years ago, and it's $70 for a reissue of Killer, but it comes with two extra discs that weren't part of that package because they're obviously trying to sell something.
Mm-hmm.
They want to make money. And I'm like, this is one of the bigger problems, is that these reissues are not true to the spirit or the quality of the original records that came out. These are made from digital masters. You mm-hmm. might as well just buy a CD. I don't know why you're buying vinyl at that point. And that's when I told you a couple of months ago, I'm not going to buy reissues anymore because it's a scam to make money. And it's not truly the original analog masters.
Right.
A lot of people like to say that, though. Digital started back in the 70s. Not quite. digital recording started back in the 70s, but we were still mastering for analog and mixing for analog back then to put on vinyl. True digital mastering and mixing didn't start until, I want to say, until the beginning of the 90s. The first time I noticed,
I got you on that one.
Okay.
Remember how I'm a diehard Rush fan?
Right.
Rush's Power Windows completely mixed and mastered digitally.
But was it...
It was 100% digital.
But it's not the kind of digital that we're talking about for today, though. This is digital tape, right? Well, not today,
but it was one of the first actual albums to be completely recorded, mixed, and mastered digitally.
1985 when it was a DDD, but that was very rare, though. The one that I can remember, earliest that I can remember, was Tusk from Fleetwood Mac, which was recorded digitally. But it was mixed analog and mastered analog. And then, like, my CDs, some of my early CDs, God, there's Dio. There was a Dio record called Lock Up the Wolves. That was recorded analog but mixed digitally and mastered digitally. And then there was, I think, Gene's Addiction, Ritual de la Habitual, was also ADD. And there was one more. Jesus Christ. It might be Rust in Peace from Megadeth.
Okay.
Those I remember being recorded analog, because every producer I've ever spoken to, I know a lot of music producers, and they say they prefer to record with analog equipment and then to mix digitally. That's their golden setup as producers. Even my friend Alex, who is a professional master, he prefers analog, but he understands now that all these reissues that we get are taken from digital masters. So what I say is, stop spending $70 for new reissues and go to eBay. You can find Alice Cooper's original Killer from 1971 on vinyl in very good to excellent condition for half that price. And you're getting the full analog experience. There's no point to listening to vinyl if you're not getting the full analog experience. And this guy got angry at me because he was like, what the fuck are you doing? I'm trying to sell this. Because that's the problem with these podcasts. A lot of them is they're trying to sell shit because they're getting a cut.
Yep.
They're getting a cut for a link from Amazon or from the distributor itself. And God bless Alice Cooper. I hope he held on to his money. But the thing is, I'm not going to spend $70 on a reissue of Killer. I'm not. I haven't.
When there's no point. I mean, you don't see me spending money on these Rush reissues that they've been making. I'm not going to spend money on that. I mean, they sound fine on the CDs I have. I don't need them to sound any better.
I have permanent waves. I got permanent waves. A used from 1979, whatever.
1980.
Copy of permanent waves, and I put it on. No skips, no pops. It sounds gorgeous. It sounds fucking gorgeous, and it's analog. It's completely analog all the way through. If you buy it now, I guarantee you, it'll sound wonderful, it'll sound beautiful, but it won't have any of the characteristics that we come to understand if you have a good discerning ear for vinyl. It won't have any of
those. You see, this all harkens back to the VHS resurgence, because people are trying to say that VHS is better, and I'm like, from a certain standpoint,
Oh my God, are people actually saying that?
People are,
Man, you don't know.
The main reason is because a lot of those older transfers were done from film prints, you know, like 35 millimeter prints and stuff like that, and they have that dingy look to them and everything like that.
Right.
So they like watching it on that old school analog. It's like me watching Laserdiscs. Like, sometimes I'll whip out the Laserdisc because I feel like slumming it and watching a film print.
I continue to hear about how Laserdisc audio is superior to all the new.
Well,
audio
it is
formats,
actually, yeah. Because if you, well, okay, because
it's lossless and everything.
Yeah, to a point. Okay, to a point. Meaning if it's like, if the movie was shot in stereo and it's a digital sound stereo disc, fuck yeah, it's going to sound amazeballs. It's going to be the best sounding thing you've ever had. But, and of course, you know, what happens when you get it on Blu-ray? Oh yeah, it's been remixed and remastered in 5.1 and the original stereo audio is nowhere to be found.
Looks very nice and clean, yeah.
Yeah, but where's the original stereo audio that we grew up with?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I'd rather have that original audio track, right? I don't want no 5.1. I don't want a 5.1 up conversion of a mono soundtrack.
Right.
That makes no sense to me. Makes zero sense. Like, best example, The Terminator. The only way to get the original uncompressed mono sound is the THX Laserdisc. All versions of The Terminator that have been released on DVD and Blu-ray have that bullshit 5.1 remix.
And yet the mono is the superior mix.
It is. It's the better.
There's just too much
mix
going on with these movies where it's you have to hear every goddamn thing. And the thing is, sometimes a movie is strongest when you don't hear every damn thing. You know, there's a great movie. Oh, well, we talked about this movie before. The Coppola movie, The Conversation.
Right.
Conversation is all about selecting sounds and isolating sounds, right? Watched it again recently, last week, with Bronwyn and Regan. We watched it. And this is a movie that doesn't give you every single sound. It only gives you the sound it wants you to hear. Now everything is like 5.1. There's so many different speakers that where you know, when you hear the coin drop, you have to hear it on this speaker, or when you hear something. I like a good stereo mix. I like it impresses me sometimes when they actually go out of their way to really create an experience where if the door closes on one side of the screen, you hear it on that speaker. I like that. I like that stuff. But what I don't like is when they go overboard.
Yeah.
There's no reason you have to. They do that with lighting, too. For some reason, you know, lighting has gotten really terrible in films if you look at them now. But I
should just say, enough of our bitching. We got to go back to Kiss.
Well, I want to make a point about the reissuing thing. Okay. And this is a problem that Kiss has now because they're just releasing their back catalog and they're trying to spruce it up because that's the only way they're going to make money because no one is paying for music anymore. The only people who are paying for music now are like real aficionados, you know, who want those sets and everything. I mean, Taylor Swift had all the entire top 10 a couple of months ago was all Taylor Swift songs. But you can guarantee she is not making a dime compared to how people made money back in the 70s and 80s, right? And
nowhere
up to
near
the late 90s. But she is all over that top 10. I stopped buying the reissues of records after I realized something. It was very disturbing and kind of depressing. I have a handful of reissues. I have The Wall, which cost me $50.
Oof.
It's a very nice package, I have to say. It's a nice package, but it cost $50. Could have gotten it on eBay for half that or even less. Case in point, Tommy. I grabbed Tommy. It's the original Decca set on vinyl. With the packaging and with all the stuff intact on the inside, including the lyrics and everything. And I got that for $14, and it's beautiful. Okay, that's an original. Now, I picked up Motley Crue, Too Fast for Love and Dr. Feelgood, two favorite records of them, and they're both reissues. And they sound okay, but they sound digital. They sound very much like they were taken from something digital. They do not sound like the original records.
Well, when it comes to Too Fast for Love, the one thing I would love to track down is the original leather records mix.
Yeah, this was not. This was, it wasn't leather. It was EMI or something, I think. Is that what it was? EMI?
Were they on? They were on Capitol.
Yeah, but it didn't say Capitol on the label. I think it said
EMI. Well, whoever bought Capitol Records, whoever has Capitol now.
Or maybe it was just a pressing from another country. Maybe it was the UK.
Oh, wait. I lied. I'm stupid. It's Elektra. Jesus Christ.
Elektra is the label later on, yeah.
That's who they signed with right
after Too Fast for Love.
Well, they did Too Fast for Love on Leather Records, and then they got their record deal with Elektra. Elektra took those tapes, remixed, redid them, and they brought out Too Fast for Love again. Like, that was, yes, it was their first record,
and
but
that's
Elektra.
And another one of these remastered on 180-gram
vinyl. 180-gram
vinyl. Which I talked to Alex, and I'm like, what's the deal with this 180-gram thing? And he says, well, in theory, he always begins every answer with in theory. So, basically, it's his way of saying, I don't know if I buy this shit, but heavier vinyl is supposed to be more stable, less warping. I'm like, okay, fine. Is there a reason why we have to pay so much more for it? And he's like, no. So the two Motley Crue records. And then I got Van Halen 2, which really upset me. Because to me, a reissue should have the same exact label, but it doesn't. It just says Warner Records on it. And I'm like looking at it, and I'm like, this is not Van Halen 2 as it was released in 79. Because I have the first Van Halen record, and I have that original Warner Brothers logo. Those are the last of them. And after that, I said, I'm not going to buy any more reissues because I feel like these are all just money grabs. And I understand why they're money grabs, because musicians aren't making money anymore. So it makes sense to me.
No, they're making money just not by – they're making their money off streaming more than they are album sales.
I can't imagine. Spotify? I mean, like, I know people are on Spotify and they don't make a dime.
Well, that's the whole Spotify really doesn't make as much as you think.
They make money for their administrators. They don't make money for the musicians that they're supposedly serving, you know?
Dude, it's a weird thing this day and age, but I get it. You know, the digital fucking MP3 bullshit revolution happened, and
MP3 revolution.
You know, I'm unfortunately on that bandwagon because, like, okay, I don't subscribe to Apple Music, but at the same time, I don't buy CDs anymore. You know,
there's no need for you. Napster. What? Napster
That was what killed it.
They were absolutely right about that. But then when Metallica arrested a 14-year-old boy, Metallica used to, you know, when they were in San Francisco and they were a nobody band, they used to hawk fucking bootlegs like crazy. And then they go and arrest children or have them and South Park did an episode where fucking SWAT team shows up in this little kid's bedroom.
Yeah.
Guns at him. Napster killed the money-making aspect of the music industry for all the cocaine-sniffing executives. That's what it did. Bands, very few bands, made money off of record sales. Because, and I've talked to a number of musicians, the kind of contract they're offered is what they like to affectionately call a slave contract. And that means we give you an enormous advance to make a record, and then we take back that money with interest and anything until we deem that we are paid back. When we deem that we're paid back is when you start making money. So that's why these bands hit the road, because that's the only way they can make their own money.
Right. By touring.
And that's part of the Bill O'Coin story. And that's why he deserved every penny back of what he got, because he invested so much money in that band.
Which I agree with. But then, like we said, what happens in the years that Kiss is starting to wane, that Kiss is not making money? Well, you know, Bill O'Coin ain't doing his job no more. Got to cut the cancer out.
They should have stuck with Bill O'Coin. The guy was he had some really great ideas. He thought,
well, at the very least, they should have renegotiated their deal with Bill O'Coin, because, hey, you want to take 50% of what we make. Well, if we're making nothing and you're getting 50% of nothing, you know, that's not working out for our favor. Right. So why don't we renegotiate the contract here? Maybe you could take less of a percentage, and then if we start making money again, if we blow up again, then maybe you can renegotiate for a little more money. They really didn't have to cut him out like that, and I agree with you.
Yeah.
I mean, they did, but they should have renegotiated rather than cut him out completely.
So we talked about the problem.
The long and short of it, I'll make it real quick. You want to talk about devotion, about a guy who kept the band together and kept him going, okay? I'm the diehard Rush fan, right?
Mm.
Ray Daniels has been their manager since the 70s. He is still, until Neil died, until they stopped touring, he was still their manager for about 40-plus years.
Yeah.
He was managing that band, okay? You know what? He must have been doing something right for, because you don't ever hear about managers staying around for 40 years.
Yeah, that's true.
You don't hear about that. And Rush was able to keep him around them years.
I'm going to say this. Rush is not your typical rock band. They were not like, I never heard stories about wild parties. I never heard stories about excessive drinking or drug use. I mean, maybe you know a little bit
They said the worst they ever did was they always had a few beers and smoked a little grass. That's all they ever did. Like, that was to the extent of their partying. Because, like, all those guys were married men with kids. Like, Neil was married with a daughter. Frickin' Alex was married with a kid.
Right.
Getty's still married to the same woman that he's been married to since the late 70s, early 80s.
Also, they look if you look at a rock band, they don't really look like a rock band. They kind of look like, scientists or professors or liberal arts majors or journalists or something like that.
Yeah, they're not the antithesis of anything rock and roll.
They saved a lot of money too. Didn't they like have their own like recording studio resources? I mean, to be basically.
Well, they used near
they
the
have their own equipment. Didn't they?
No, they did not, because like the first couple, I could tell you right now, the first right after 2112 hit big, they did Hemispheres and A Farewell to Kings in England, and they hated working in England so much that they decided to go to the studio in Toronto, and that's where they've been working. That's where they pretty much worked ever since.
Where they were at where it was up in the mountains, in the snowy mountains?
I think that was Le Studio. That was the one where they record. Le Studio, yeah. The Studio. Le Studio.
Le Studio, yes.
That's where they recorded Moving Pictures in 1980. They just got away to the mountains and just fucking recorded, you know?
That's the way you should record, really.
You see, that, like, that's the greatest comparisons you can make about Kiss and Rush, is because at the end of the day, these are still bands that are big cult bands, and where Rush is now starting to become a merchandise label. But at the same time, I'm happy with that because Rush is no longer a band. They didn't start merchandising the shit out of themselves until they were done touring. Until they said, hey, we're done. We're retired. We're out of the game.
Yeah.
You know, now it's merchandise.
I also want to point out that Rush, they sold more records than Kiss, and they had much more chart action, and they had much more loyalty from their fans. Their fans stayed loyal to them, and that's one of the big problems with Kiss, too. Another problem I'm going to bring up is that the fans ditched Kiss. They ditched them. Maybe they grew up. Maybe they got smarter. Maybe they moved over to Rush. Maybe Rush got more fans over the years. But when I look at the sales of albums and I look at the shows, Rush did so much better than Kiss after a certain time. I mean, like, Kiss had some really great years for 3 years. The 3 years that we all remember and the 3 years that we're probably talking about. You know, I mean, we're talking about, well, we're starting at the beginning, right?
Yeah, but we're pretty much right before Destroyer, so their best years were like 75 to 78, or one could argue 76 to 79, right around the Dynasty Tour, right around there.
We're going to talk about the records for a second, and everybody's heard all the various, you know, opinions and stuff. The first record is considered one of the best because it has every single song on it is a classic. It's a staple of the concert, except for Kiss and Time, even though I think Kiss and Time is a cute song.
But I actually like Love Theme from Kiss. That's Love a good little instrumental. Kiss,
which is, yeah, actually the original version of that was called Acrobat, and they used it in a live show. I don't know why they changed it to Love Theme from Kiss. Acrobat is a cooler. But it was like this instrumental that went on for 6 or 7 minutes. They kind of cut it down to like the 2 or 3 minutes that it is on the record. But you have like Deuce, Strutter. You have Cold Gin, which is
Black
like,
Diamond.
Black Diamond. And this is rock and roll. This is guitar. And it's like Frehley's guitar is incredible on these first two records. Even on Hotter Than Hell, it managed to outshine the terrible production.
The production, yes.
My favorite Ace Frehley guitar solo is Strange Ways. That is like Strange Ways when you hear Strange Ways. Ace Frehley's guitar solo is absolutely insane. That is a song, and it's a song he wrote. And he wrote it for Peter Criss because he wasn't singing yet. He didn't start singing until Love Gun. But
yep.
He does sing backup on a couple of records. And Hotter Than Hell, like I said, really fantastic songs, but terrible.
Yeah, great
production.
Songs, just a terrible sounding album.
You got to hear Anthrax's cover of Parasite. It is absolutely insane. And it is so the song that it should have been.
See, one of my favorite jams off that is Going Blind. I love that song.
Going Blind.
Going Blind.
I have to say, also, I watched a video of Elvis Presley's stepbrother was a big Kiss fan. And he was listening to Hotter Than Hell. And he was playing. Elvis said, I want to hear some of that. Because it sounded really cool to him. So he's like, I really like Let Me Go Rock and Roll. And I know why Elvis liked that song. Because it has kind of like a rockabilly, hard rock thing going on. But it was really cool to hear that Elvis Presley, kind of he liked Kiss.
Oh, good. Then he wasn't a pretend. Even though he loved his cheeseburgers, he wasn't a pretentious
asshole. He loved his cheeseburgers, peanut butter and banana sandwiches, too. And on the day Elvis died, which was it was August in 77, Kiss was on tour. And they got the news that Elvis died. So they played Jailhouse Rock. They did their own cover of Jailhouse Rock, which I thought was pretty cool.
That's awesome.
So moving on to Dressed to Kill, they cut out all the bullshit. Neil Bogart didn't have any money, so he came in and produced the record himself with Kiss. Sonically, it sounds way better than Hotter Than Hell. Some really good songs in there, of course.
Yeah, sonically better, but the songs, while they're good, they're nowhere near as good as the first two albums. I mean, yes, you have Rock and Roll,
you know.
Oh, you have Rock and Roll All Night. Yes, you have, like I said, Come On and Love Me. Yes, two great songs. See, the problem with that album is, the album to me is, even though it sounds great, it's pretty forgettable.
I like,
I know you love it, though, and that's fine.
It's kind of like dirty, hard sex rock or something like that. It's like the stuff that Guns N' Roses did.
Well, I do like Room Service. I totally forgot the opening track, Room Service.
Maybe Guns N' Roses and Aerosmith, a little bit of that, too, kind of in there. Aerosmith is another band that outperformed Kiss, but they did have their very bad period right before they got their new contract with Geffen, I think it was.
Yeah, well,
Done With Mirrors was their first Geffen record, but that didn't chart very well.
The thing that saved Aerosmith was working with outside songwriters, okay?
You mean like those same songwriters that worked with Kiss?
What
right?
Do you think Kiss did in the 80s, man? They did the same shit.
Yeah, Diane Warren.
Diane Warren, fucking Desmond Child.
Desmond Child.
Holly Vance. You know, these are all people. And Jim Vellance, even him too. These
and
are
Brian
all
Adams.
People. Yeah. These are all people that Aerosmith and Kiss both used to resurge their careers in the 80s.
They did, because apparently there's a lot of antipathy between the bands, isn't there?
And well, didn't it's they? Weird. They toured together, though. They fucking toured together not too long ago.
But Aerosmith popped really early on with Dream On. That was their big hit.
Well, hold on. Not realistically. Dream On was a local hit when it came out. Okay, it was a very local hit. But then when Toys in the Attic broke big, they re-released Dream On as a single, and it became a top 10 hit. Kiss and Aerosmith both hit in 75. They both hit
But
big.
For some reason, okay. Yeah, they toured together for a little bit, and Joe Perry appears on Gene Simmons' solo album. But then, for some reason, there's a lot of antipathy at the end of the 90s between them. This was around the time that Aerosmith suddenly became this huge... Well, they became a huge band at the beginning of the 90s because of Permanent Vacation and Pump and then Get a Grip. And I had all those records. I even met Aerosmith. They signed something for me for free. I want to point out, for free. This is another thing I hate. When you're charging for autographs.
Yeah.
All the best autographs I have are free. I got the entire band Aerosmith to sign a picture. Just because I went to Sam Goody and stood in line for about 20 minutes, 9 a.m. in the morning, chatting with their bodyguard, who's like this really huge black guy who's 7 feet tall, 300 pounds, and he was the nicest guy in the world. And I was talking to him. I was having a conversation with him. I guess he liked me or something because he moved me ahead in the line. Or he was just trying to get rid of me. But anyway, I went in there and got them to sign. I got fucking Ozzy to sign something once for free. I mean, it was hilarious.
Well, dude, to a lesser band extent, I got Styx to sign an album cover for me.
Hey, man, Styx is nothing to sneeze at, man.
Yeah, I got them to sign an album cover.
I listened to Pieces of Eight. It's a fantastic record. They're like an American...
See, yeah, you looked at that list I gave you, and you're just like, I should listen to Pieces of Eight, and you're like, damn, John's right. That's a great fucking record. That's an amazing progressive album.
You know what they remind me so much of, like, an American version of Queen back then. There was just the way they constructed their songs is very Queen-like.
It just sucks. That's
they didn't
where
have
Styx
the Brian May guitar, though.
It just sucks that's where Styx peaked with 78, because anything they did after that was no... I mean, yes,
well,
we had Cornerstone.
Was also a concept record.
Right? that fucking
no,
record.
No, Domo Regato, Mr. Roboto?
Dude, Domo? I that
Thank
is
you very
one
much,
of my...
Mr. Roboto.
That album, to me, is a guilty pleasure record. I will
it's the
not
elder.
Ever...
It's their elder.
Yeah, it's a guilty pleasure album.
Although
it's
that was a
like...
top 10 record, and that's the thing. Kiss did not stay within... their wheelhouse, so that's why every deviation that they made was met with derision and bad sales. But we're jumping ahead of ourselves. What was I talking about? I was talking about
Dress to Kill, Dress to Kill, and the polished sound and everything like that.
Well, like I said, Kiss had the big years of their lives in those first couple of years before 78. I want to say 78 is probably the nadir of their success. Because they, you know, they did some crazy things there. But all these other bands that were not quite as popular as Kiss back then suddenly they exploded in the 90s. And Rush was still putting out records that were top 10 records.
Because that was the thing about Rush. They were not a singles band. Like, believe it or not, Rush only ever had one top 20 hit. One.
Mm.
And that was New World Man, 82. But all their albums, every album they ever sold was always a top 10 record.
Right.
Because they were, again, the following that they had.
But remember what I asked you. What are the things you remember most about Kiss? The makeup.
Yep.
The iconic logo. Yes. Music comes a distant third or fourth. But what do you remember? What do I remember? I'm about as big on Rush as you are on Kiss. So you're the Rush guy. I'm the Kiss guy. But if you ask me about Rush, I'll say... Tom Sawyer. I'll say Power Trio. I'll say Canada. I'll say Geddy Lee, because Geddy Lee has a very distinctive voice. Neil Peart, drums. Unfortunately, Alex Lifeson is number three, I guess. But, I mean, fine guitars. I remember, I said Tom Sawyer. Limelight, Spirit of Radio.
Free Will.
Free Will.
2112, Temples of Syrinx.
Well, see, now you're going off the reservation there. Sorry.
No. Temple of Syrinx is like the big radio hit.
You are the Rush fan. You're the Rush fan. I'm telling you, this is what non-Rush people know about Rush. They know those qualities about the band. And I don't think that Rush ever ventured outside or did anything scary or stupid in their career. Did they?
Well, they changed their sound up a little. Remember, they were heavy progressive.
Well, I have Roll the Bones on tape, and Roll the Bones doesn't. The only thing that changes as far as from hemispheres to roll the bones is just the recording instruments, whatever they use. But the thing is, that's because it's the 80s. What, in 89, I think that record came
out. I guess the biggest thing here is in the 80s.
Still a top 10 record.
They were starting to use more synthesizers in the 80s, and they got a little new wavy.
Yeah, but there's nothing scary or crazy about that. That sounds completely logical with a band like Rush that they would do that. They had
yes.
No, they had synthesizers, man. Tom Sawyer has synthesizers, you know?
Well, right, but that's what I'm saying. It's like they didn't really start using like heavy synthesizers until Permanent Waves. Like, yes, there was some synth in like Farewell to Kings, and there was some synth in Hemispheres, but they really started using the synths in freaking Permanent Waves and Moving Pictures.
But my question,
and then right after that, like, dude, the song that does it all, Subdivisions. You know, it's like dun 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 dun. It's all synth. And that whole album is pretty much a synth record, but I love it.
Well,
anyway.
You're talking about Rush like you would a wine connoisseur would discuss a very good vintage of wine.
And this is why I can't talk Rush for a lot of people, because I'm like the diehard.
But my
like,
question for
I
you
don't
is,
get it.
Did Rush ever do anything to piss off their fans? I don't think
no.
they ever did, right?
They never once
they
did.
They never did. There are controversies, you know. Joe Perry left Aerosmith, pissed off the fans. Sammy Hagar, David Lee Roth, piss off the fans.
The only other band that you could compare to Rush, I hate to say, is ZZ Top.
ZZ
because
Top,
if you
three
look at
guys.
It, it's just, it's been until, Billy Gibbons died,
Yeah.
Okay. It was them same three fucking guys.
Yeah, there is something I can point to this, though, for ZZ Top. ZZ Top is very interesting. It's interesting that you bring it up. ZZ Top, when they were early on, they were like dirty party country hard rock, right? They even screamed in their songs. That guy, he screamed. Fandango is like one of my favorite records, and Tejas as well. Two early ones. Then what happens? In the 80s, you get what's that? What's the name of the record?
Eliminator.
Eliminator, right? With Give Me All Your Lovin' and Sharp Dressed Man and Legs. Suddenly yep. it becomes this kind of 80s pop thing, and they become really popular. And they got the
But then
beards.
The cool thing is that album opens up with Got Me Under Pressure, and that's like a good fucking rock song right there.
There's also Velcro but, Fly.
Well, that I was just going to say, Velcro Fry's on Afterburner, and that right there is like a straight 80s song. However, the best song off that record is Can't Stop Rockin'. The very last song. That just sounds like...
Yeah, there's two, though. There's two... No, three, maybe... Okay, yeah. Eliminator, Afterburner, and Recycler?
Yes. Eliminator, Afterburner, and Recycler.
Right. These are the big pop records of their career. But then what happens after that? They go back to their roots. They go back to the psychobilly kind of stuff. You know, you listen to that stuff on the From Dusk Till Dawn soundtrack. My God! Those songs are so fucking wicked. I
yep.
love hearing them. And they also bring back... It's like ZZ Top had their little moment in the desert where they were a pop band, and then they went back to what they were. And they still kept their fans. They still kept their fans. They kept their fan base. This is
yeah,
the,
so
you know.
Rush and ZZ Top are pretty much two of the only bands you could think of that were never mired in controversy. They just another
as
band
far
you
as
could
rock
also
bands,
say
yes.
the great well, you could also say one could also say the Grateful Dead. Because until yeah, Jerry Berry died, awesome. You know, they were you know, they hey, Grateful Dead. I am not a Deadhead.
Cherry
All
Garcia.
I know, they just did them. Their
yeah,
whole
no,
entire
they
career,
they, like,
they just did.
I know. I swear to God, I know a lot of fan. I know a lot, I have a lot of friends, some dear dear people I absolutely love, who are absolute Grateful Dead lunatics. You know, Deadheads and so.
You know, another band
Fish too.
Yeah, I was just about to. I was fucking. You read my mind. Get out of my head, dude.
I had a girl.
I fucking
but I
was
a girl.
Just about to say Fish. They're not in controversy.
I had a girl take
play.
Me to a Fish concert. And she was in love with them, and she kept looking at me, and I was just like, "What's the big deal? I don't understand." It's a bunch of 20-year-olds acting.
You've
like
You've
got
to run. I cannot stand fucking Fish. It's
I mean,
terrible.
What do they do? They
the
smoke
only thing
a lot
I like
of
about
weed,
Fish
and there's
is
like nitrous tanks for whippets and stuff like that. You know,
the only thing Fish ever did was make a good ice cream.
Fish food.
That is
fish
the
food,
greatest.
Right next to Cherry Garcia.
Exactly. That is the greatest fucking ice cream on the planet. I've been a fan of that shit for over 20 years. Oh.
If you move away from rock and roll, there are a couple of there's a couple of bands that stuck. U2 comes to mind. They stuck together.
Stuck together no matter what.
Still,
and
huge.
But they've had some controversy over the years. You know that whole
Bono
you know dropping
a,
the album for free on Apple.
Bono
and
being made
like
of
that.
Shit. You know, basically.
Yeah, but and then they came
he's
out
like,
with
really,
fucking.
He's a great guy.
Well, dude,
he
they came
the
out with two.
Us,
they came out. I hate U2, but they came out with two dog shit fucking records, man. The Zuropa or whatever that is, and then the one that had discotheque, like Pop, I think was the name of the album or whatever that was.
I like early. I like early U2. I like
Boy, dude. Fucking Boy is
favorite,
probably
my favorite U2 record is October. I like listening to October, and that was a record that barely charted, you know. So what has this, what have been, we've been mainly talking about is fan loyalty. So this is when Kiss had all the big, this is when they started to really get noticed because they developed a really good reputation as a live band. And they went to all the places that a lot of other bands wouldn't go to, like Cadillac, Michigan, or Jackson, Wyoming, or Cleveland. Cleveland back then was a dump. And I know this because I'm from Ohio. Cleveland was considered like, it's like what Detroit is now to Michigan. It was such a dump. They cleaned it up a lot because they put the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame there.
Yeah.
I hate the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame too, by the way. That's another problem, man. So they went to these places and they developed an incredible following. And that's where the majority of Alive was recorded, in places like Cleveland and in Cobo Hall, stuff like that. And then after that, the sky opened, so to speak. Even though the record really, according to the Wikipedia page, the record has sold over 8 million copies worldwide, which really, when you think about it, still isn't that much.
That's really not.
Compared to like other bands of the time. 8 million is really good, though, considering what it did for Casablanca. It did put Casablanca on the map, but unfortunately, Casablanca was not as big. If Kiss had had a contract, if they had had Asylum or Warner Brothers or Atlantic, they would have been consistently a top 10 band because Casablanca wasn't shipping as many records back then. It's kind of like,
Eventually they did, though, because, like, remember when the four solo albums came out, they shipped platinum.
Oh, yeah, when they lied.
Yeah, when they lied. Yeah.
It was actually, you know what it was? It was Neil Bogart being Brian Epstein. Brian Epstein did this with the Beatles to give them a chart position so that people would see who they were, what their name was, put them on the map. He owned record stores and he bought Beatles records to put in there. That was back when you measured sales by how much the record store would buy, not by actual sales like SoundScan, right, like what we do now, which is very interesting because nobody's buying records anymore.
Well, that was the corporate boogie. But point is, you're right. At the beginning, Casablanca couldn't do that because then they couldn't, you know, meet demand. But then by the time the company got cash infused, then they could start selling like multi-platinum, that kind of thing. But then, like you said, it was off what the record stores bought, not what the consumer bought.
And that's how, I mean, and the thing is, it's a kind of a payola thing, basically, because Casablanca didn't have a deal with, and record companies are not, I'm sorry, radio stations did not play Casablanca records. The FM ones, anyway. AM ones would, AM rock would, but FM didn't. And the reason FM didn't is because Casablanca did not do payola with them. That's one of the reasons why The Wall was such a huge success, is because the record company basically bribed radio stations to play the record, and thus they got sales. And this happened a lot. That was one thing Casablanca didn't do. I thought that very, very noble and honorable, is that they did not, you know, pay off record radio stations to play.
They said, let's let the work speak for itself. You know,
yeah, and unfortunately, you know, the thing is, if they had that deal, if Kiss had a deal with Warner Brothers or something like that, Warner Brothers was huge. You could find them everywhere.
Well, it's because of all the subsidiaries they had, like you mentioned Asylum, you mentioned Atlantic. These are all Warner Brothers subsidiaries.
And,
you know,
what's there's
Elektra
is
a Warner Brothers subsidiary.
Reprise.
Yeah. Reprise is, well, Reprise didn't start out like that, but it became a Warner Brothers.
Reprise,
that was Frank
started,
Sinatra.
I think it was Sinatra
that was
started.
Sinatra,
that, right?
Sinatra started Reprise,
and then Warner
bought
it.
Yeah, Warner bought it. So, but point is, like, okay, even more so, like Geffen was originally under Warner, but then that became Universal. Universal got Geffen.
Yeah, and then Geffen started his own label called DGC.
Well, Geffen, actually, Geffen was he was responsible for Asylum.
Yeah,
but then they created the Geffen Company, you know, David Geffen, John Peters, Peter Guber, you know, then they created that whole thing. That was after the whole PolyGram thing, which we'll get into later on. That's pretty much, I hate to say it, that's what Casablanca became, because like John Peters, Peter Guber, David Geffen, they all got their fingers in the dike, so to speak, with Casablanca, and then it all became the Geffen Company after that. Pretty much.
You know, all the executives, they just changed the name. And then Bogart left. I mean, well, he was forced out after the sale. After PolyGram got controlling interest of Casablanca, they forced him out. He started another record company and became a huge success as a result of Joan Jett, which was incredible.
Blackheart Records.
So he had like a he had an eye for talent. He really liked just spending money more than any.
He just really liked putting it up his nose, basically.
Well, him and Larry Harris. I don't know. You know, the thing that's so weird about Bogart is that he died at such a young age. How the fuck do you die of cancer when you're not even 40 practically?
I don't know.
I just
wasn't
so
it lung
weird.
Cancer.
I'm not. It just said cancer in the Wikipedia. It didn't okay. tell me what kind. It could have been any kind. I mean, if it's pancreatic, it's a death sentence anyway.
Yeah.
Finishing up with Alive, it does become this enormous success, but for some reason they never recertified any of the records. I saw a recent podcast, a podcast where they talked about how all these other bands recertify mm-hmm. to get new numbers on sales, and Kiss never did that for some reason. And I don't understand why, because they claim they've sold over 100 million records worldwide. I don't know. I don't know if that's true. I know they have a lot of gold records, but I do also know that they started getting higher chart placement. They never had a number one record. The closest they ever got was number two.
It wasn't that Love Gun?
No. Love Gun I know Love Gun did not make it, because number two was one of their more recent ones, I think Monster or Sonic Boom, I forget.
Oh, okay.
One of the bullshit records, basically.
Yeah.
Let me check Love Gun's position here, chart action. Yeah, number four is as high as Love Gun went. And another problem was that Casablanca didn't get really good distribution overseas, so they didn't get much in the way of great sales overseas. That they were all imports that they had to get. It wasn't until Polygram. Polygram was an international company. So that's when you started to see sales of their records really do very well overseas as a result of the deal with Polygram.
Well, yeah, because didn't that happen in the, like, near the tail end of the 70s, early into the 80s, when Polygram, like, absorbed them all completely?
Polygram absorbed them around the time of Unmasked, and Unmasked was a huge hit overseas. But there was also the fact that they refused. You know, there were things that they did as a band that were kind of questionable. I don't know. There was this whole thing about the identity. They didn't want to show their faces. So journalists didn't tend to take them seriously as a result of that. It's not, what are you guys, a bunch of jokes and everything. And Gene Simmons tried to rationalize it for a lot of people. I forgot what he said. He said something.
Well, I mean,
about,
but then you look at bands today. You look at bands like Slipknot. You know, it took them a while to see what they looked like from outside under the mask. You know, and Slipknot was a band that was inspired by Kiss. You have another female artist named Sia Berler. She hides her face underneath her hair so no one can really see what she looks like. You know, so it's
so
a
it's like
shtick.
Cousin It.
It's a shtick. I mean, there's other bands out there like fucking Mushroom Head. They're the same thing. I've seen them live. Yeah. You got Coil that were doing, or not Coil, fucking Bile, who used to fucking play that shit. You know, point is,
even before you had Klaatu, which nobody knew who they were, and everybody thought they were the Beatles. And then you had The Residents. The Residents would wear astronaut helmets on their head and you couldn't see their faces.
So, I mean, I can understand why there was some backlash, you know, later on, because then people didn't start taking, they weren't taking them as a band seriously. They were taking it as more as like shtick.
Mm.
You know, like these aren't serious musicians. These are just entertainers, you know, and the music's not that good. But then one of the main reasons, like Shandy, I know you're talking about Unmasked. I don't want to get too far ahead.
Shandy
became a big hit in Australia, I believe.
Yeah,
and that
New
was
Zealand,
because
they love it.
Yeah,
they
toured
it.
Over there. Nobody, you know, that was their first time touring overseas, because they mainly stuck to the continental U.S. for most of their time Dynasty.
Destroyer, in the 76, they went to Japan. They were huge in Japan. And you know why they were huge in Japan. Because
the Kabuki makeup?
Yeah, because they look like Kabuki. That was insane. They were huge. They went to, and what's more, their success translated to Cheap Trick. Cheap Trick became huge in Japan as well. That's why you have the Budokan.
Yeah, Cheap Trick at Budokan. That's where Kiss played Budokan.
That was like their biggest selling record, and it also outsold Alive. And it was just, I don't know if they did any overdubbing on Budokan. I have that record. I listened to it. It's a good record. I like it. It's interesting because at that time, that was 1979 for Cheap Trick. Cheap Trick is another band that always had a loyal fan base. That's another one you can mention. They didn't.
Robin Zander. That's the only person I know from Cheap Trick is Robin Zander.
Well, there's Bunny Carlos and there's Rick Nielsen. Rick Nielsen is the glue that held Cheap Trick together because he produced the records for them. And they stuck together and they were not as popular as they were. They never quite broke. They had a couple of huge hits. Heaven Tonight.
Dream Police.
Dream Police
big one.
is I like that album. That's probably number two. No. Let's put it this way. I like Heaven Tonight first. I like Budokan second. And I like Dream Police third. And then also at the end of the 80s, they had a resurgence. They had a number one hit with The Flame. They had some really great records, and they continue to put out music right now to this very day. They just put out a record last year.
Mm.
It's insane. They continue to work. And I like a lot of what Cheap Trick is about, because it's part of that power pop thing. Power pop is something I really enjoy, especially late 70s, early 80s.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the greatest move for Kiss, even though I do enjoy Unmasked more than most people. I do enjoy Paul Stanley's solo record. That's all power pop. We're talking about, like, let's say, Rick Springfield, Working Class Dog is like...
Living in Oz, man. Success Hasn't Spoiled Me. I have three great records. Love all of them.
And it's power pop. And that's Elvis Costello, too, is another one I really like. I listen to Elvis Costello occasionally. I listened to some last night, actually. The problem with Kiss is that they tended to hop onto trends, and we'll get into that in our next conversation, because we're going to talk about the
later. Yeah, we'll get into that in the latter years.
But this is right now. We're talking about glitter rock. We're talking about what is possibly my favorite record of that early time, which is Destroyer, produced by Bob Ezrin. It is in my top five. Every song on it, I absolutely love. What do you think of Destroyer?
I've always said it's a good album. I think it's a landmark album, unfortunately. I think the album that came out after, that's the better record.
Well, Rock and Roll Over?
Yes, I think that's the better record. That's my favorite Kiss album.
I like Rock and Roll Over.
No disrespect against Bob Ezrin. No disrespect against the man whatsoever. I always thought Destroyer was a little too polished for its own good.
It's almost...
I think Rock and Roll Over, I think, is just Kiss in the studio, barely any overdubs, just playing live and playing
you like
a good
that
fucking
kind of
record.
Just kind of straight stripped down thing going on.
That then you got it. Like that right
I
there.
I enjoy the
stripped
down
that
approach.
That is a Kiss
too.
Stripped down. That's why I love Rock and Roll Over.
I enjoy the stripped down approach, but I also enjoy the... A lot of people disagree with this. You might too, but I consider Destroyer to be a concept album.
Well, kind of is.
There's a lot of thought put into how the whole thing is put out. And also, Ezrin's a thinker. He's a thinker at the board. He's like, how do I get an effect? He's looking for an effect. Kramer is more of a, okay, I hit the record button, go, I guess. So, you know, and then they perform that way. But Ezrin is a knob twirler. That's what Rolling Stone magazine used to call Ezrin. They called him a knob twirler. So he would do anything to get an effect, and he does. Every song on the record is just wonderful. I love listening to it, especially around Christmas time. I don't know why. For some reason, putting on Destroyer and you're looking at a Christmas tree, that's like one of my favorite things.
Kiss Save Santa.
You just keep practicing that guitar, Santa. Maybe we'll let you do a solo.
Everyone loves Destroyer. I think Rock and Roll Over and Love Gun, those are like the two... Those are like the two gold standard Kiss records right there, man. That's the gold standard for me.
I think that Eddie Kramer's best work is live. That's why they get him to produce the live records. He produced Alive, he produced Alive 2, and he produced Alive 3. And they all sound beautiful. Alive 2 is a little scratchy. I don't know why. I wish they could remaster that one a little bit more.
Alive 3 had the benefit of being done in the 90s.
Alive 3 is gorgeous to listen to. Great sound. It's very close to Alive 1, the first one.
I think Alive 2 was probably thrown together very quickly because they were, you got to remember, they had the two compilation albums right after Love Gun. They had Alive 2, and then they had freaking Double Platinum.
Alive 2 has, I think it had some problems because they had a completely different track order originally, and they were going to incorporate their Tokyo concerts. But for some reason, I don't know, maybe there was something wrong with the audio. So they very quickly put together a lot of sound checks and stuff. Yeah, there's a lot of fabrication going on with that.
Yeah, there's like I said, that.
But the Alive 5 songs on side 4 are awesome. Rocket Ride is my favorite Ace Frehley song ever.
But right, you even said Destroyer, so we were saying, move on to Rock and Roll Over. I've said that is just a great stripped down version of Kiss. And then I think Love Gun is like, it has the theatricality of Destroyer, it has the ambition of Destroyer, but the stripped down sound of Rock and Roll Over. Because nothing sounds like, it just doesn't sound polished, but yet it just sounds great. I love every song off that album.
There's some fun songs on Love Gun. Maybe it's where I maybe of the moment, I'm thinking I like Love Gun more than Rock 'Em All Over because there's a, like, well, you got, it's the first time you have all four band members singing.
Yes.
Ace Frehley's first song, Shock Me. One of my favorites. I love it. I love Plaster Caster. It's a stupid song.
And it's a ridiculous song, but it's a fun song.
And it's about a girl who digs plaster cast molds of famous rock star penises, you know?
I Stole Your Love. That's a great song.
Christine 16. Fucking Almost Human. God, I love that song. That is such a funky... That may be the very first example of what could be disco. Because there's a very disco thing going on in that song.
So, like I said, we've hit the high water mark here because unfortunately there's nowhere else to, it all goes down, levels out, and goes downhill again. Or I should say it's like a roller coaster. It goes downhill, levels off, peaks just a bit more, and then it goes down and levels off again.
Right. So we should probably stop here.
Yeah, this is where we stop.
I didn't even want to go as far as Love Gun. I wanted to stop at Destroyer because Destroyer is sort of the beginning of... I would say Destroyer is the end. Destroyer is the end of the first Kiss music band. This is the end of Before the Money right here because this is when they became really huge. It was in 1976.
Yeah.
Between Destroyer and Rock and Roll Over because... Then you saw that people were buying records and their records were staying on the charts for a much longer time now. The visual sense of the band is really sold on their album covers. And it's strange because Neil Bogart does not go beyond that. He does not go into music videos. He does not do as much. The merchandising doesn't start until 77, I would say, right?
You're right about 76, 77, I would say that's when the merchandising really... I mean, you're the one who's old enough. I'm just going off
this is, but this is the end of the glitter rock age, the glam rock age of New York. And the costumes sort of reflect it in a way because there's this great glitter about the costumes on the Destroyer cover. I have the Destroyer cover. I will take a video of it. I have a framed portrait of the Kiss Destroyer album cover. And I haven't hung it yet. It's still sitting on my thing over there on my little coffee end table. Mm. But it's basically a blown up version of the Destroyer album cover, and it's probably my favorite because to me it's the most iconic of all of them.
It is, and you're absolutely right. That is probably the most iconic record cover that the band ever did because that's the one they used everywhere. I mean, second to Love Gun because they did use the Love Gun, you know, art a little bit too. In certain posters that you see, but Destroyer, it's just an iconic album cover.
And for me, Bob Ezrin is instrumental in their success. He's also instrumental in their failure. And he's instrumental in their later success, their best album. As far as I'm concerned, their best album without makeup, Revenge.
Yep.
And he produced it. And he was sort of there for all those phases. The only phase... It's weird, too, because he gets the original. He produces Destroyer, which is the original lineup. Then he produces The Elder, which is their next lineup after with Eric Carr. And then he produces Revenge, which is their next lineup with Bruce Kulick and Eric Singer. You'd think he should have been there. He should have produced Psycho Circus, but he didn't. They got Bruce Fairburn for that.
And plus, less we say about it, the better. Ace and Peter didn't even play on it.
Practically no.
Practically
anything,
no.
Anything that they did play on, the songs weren't used. It's so bizarre. But I also want to say that my last thought about this. Kiss stopped being a band after 1997. After Carnival of Souls, they stopped being a band. They started being this corporate entity, this Carnival Roadshow, this sideshow, this revival thing. That's just how I see it. I think Carnival of Souls was the last you saw of what actually Kiss was as a rock band.
And that didn't even come out until after Psycho Circus.
Yeah,
I know.
They had the, yeah, it's funny. I have a story about that when we get to it. But
okay.
For now, we're wrapping up with, let's wrap it up with, I guess, Love Gun, right? This is when Kiss ruled the world, pretty much.
Yep, when Kiss ruled the world, pretty much. Yes. Time I would have loved to have been there for, but yes, like you said, this is when Kiss ruled the world.